Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Matt Naylor, and I serve as the President and CEO at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and we're really glad to have you here. That's a really full weekend of activities, and we're also so pleased to be hosting the Vietnam Wall, travelling Vietnam Wall, 400 feet, 80% replica of the memorial in DC. Most appropriate to have that here, given that this is our first Memorial Day weekend, where in the newly designated National World War I Memorial. So we're very glad to have that, which then leads us to this opportunity to have conversation about the linkages between World War I and the Vietnam War and of Vietnam itself. So we're very delighted today to have with us Dr. Kimloan Hill, who will be sharing with us. She's a specialist in colonial and contemporary Vietnam, a research focus on Southeast Asian history, and has written extensively about the experiences and the impact of World War I on Vietnam and colonial power structures. So she is herself a expert in the Vietnamese language and cultural, social, political, and economic histories of Vietnam, well experienced and published in this area. The format that we're going to take is that Dr. Hill will present for about 15 minutes, make some remarks, and then she and I are going to sit in our lounge room, and if it was later in the day, we would have a bottle of wine, and we will then have a conversation together about some of the themes which have emerged. And then there'll be an opportunity for some question and answer with the audience, and then we'll be drawing the conversation to a close at about 2 o'clock. So that's the format, and I think it's going to be nice if you'd like to sit any closer, do that. We are filming today in order for us to be able to share this. This is an area of conversation where we don't have a lot of content. And so this is a wonderful opportunity for us to enrich our academic offerings. So it's going to be, I think, a really nice conversation for us. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join with me in welcoming Dr. Kimloan Hill to the podium.
Good afternoon. I'm so glad that I see all of you here. Actually, I was from Missouri, you know that. I escaped Vietnam, so I'm come back home. Today I come home. The last time I'm home was 1997. So it's so nice to see you. If you will, let's just see, it can bring, so I will talk about the Vietnamese participation in World War I. You probably heard about Australian, New Zealander, you heard about Chinese participation in World War I, but not about Vietnamese in World War I. You heard about Vietnamese through the U.S. involvement in Vietnam after the division of Vietnam, probably in 1960, and war with the, between the U.S. and Vietnam will have a great impact on the U.S., but those are the pictures of Vietnamese. They went to France and they participated in the war in France. You can see the first one, the Chinese and Vietnamese subtitle there, but they are military laborers that went to France and they were ready to go to the field to dig trenches. And you can see let's just see if I could do the, oops, I could do the, okay, I do it wrong. Right there, this is a Vietnamese worker in the factory producing whatever he does, but I think that ammunition. And there's a Vietnamese soldier who stand guard in Paris. And these are the pictures of Vietnamese soldier. All of these are princes in the royal family. All of them, but they volunteer to be soldier in the French army. And these are workers, you can see they producing munition here, all right? And so those pictures speak out loud, speak loudly to the perception among American scholars that Vietnamese were conscripted to World War I. Because at that time, Vietnam was a colony of the French Empire in the Far East. The French have colonies in Vietnam and in China. And so people, scholar perception that Vietnamese people was conscripted. But based on this picture, you know that I'm not saying that they're happy, but they wanted to go. And when they go to France, they change. They change their perception about the French later in my conclusion, and they change their perception of important, most importantly about themselves. As you can see the picture before I show you this picture, Vietnamese peasant was poor and illiterate, and the Vietnamese, they are not like this when they go to France, but you see how it is changed, how they were changed. So the sources of my book or my talk today are from all of these sources, from French military archive, from French government, from contemporary newspaper, and letter, especially letter of Vietnamese soldier in World War I. And of course, some book, but my books are from France, not from the US. And these are the outline of my talk, or the PowerPoint that I will talk briefly on history of colonization, chronologies of the recruiting process, and some volunteer, and then some not volunteer, and their journey, and their distribution when they went to France, and post-war development and impact of war in Vietnam. All of these I touch very briefly. I will not be able to go to details. But if you have questions later on, you can talk when I sit down and talk. These are just a outline of the Vietnam involvement in World War I. And as you know, Vietnam became a colony of France in toward the middle of 19th century. And because Vietnam was a colony of France, and when France need more labor for World War I, they enlisted labor from the colonies. Vietnam was part of French Empire, but because this was a part of the empire, they went to Vietnam and recruit Vietnamese, but I hate to say that nearly all Vietnamese did not go to France until 1914. So those are the pictures of soldiers from the empire, from the French empire, Vietnamese and African. They were enlisted to go to France during World War I. In Vietnam, the mobilization process didn't begin until 1916. Around August of 1915, they sent a troop of a few thousand Vietnamese to France as a trial group. To test it out to see if Vietnamese people would be able to survive in France in the winter and in the cold weather. And it worked out very well, so they started a campaign by December 15, and the campaign recruited altogether nearly 100,000 men to go to France. And here, this is the recruiting process. They use, just like any campaign, they use poster, they use local people to advertising for the process, and all of the Vietnamese was promised money, bonus. They was promised have medical care where they are in France. Their family got bonuses, and they got family get the allowances. So this is a lot for Vietnamese, because at that time, a coolie worked only 10 cents a day, and if they went to France, they make 4 piastres a day, which is 400 times more. And so they went, and at the time that they go, Vietnam was having terrible natural disaster, flood and drought. And I'm talking about millions of people was hungry and have no job, and the flood just wiped out the rice field. So they went to France. They was promised to go to France. So they volunteered. But there was people that who were, you can see these are the poster, and they were published in 1915. And so these are the volunteer. The volunteer, they are military soldier. If some of you were in the military, you know that you have to go wherever the government sent you. So there was a couple thousand of them that went to France because they were in the military, and they were reservists that was in active military duty, and they have to go. And the I would say 7/8 of the 100, so about 87,000, they were all volunteer, and they were peasant. They were skilled worker, that welders, and no electrician, but welder, the people, the blacksmith, and all of those people, they were hospital worker, and even student, they volunteer to go to France. Why they want to volunteer? A few years ago, I gave a talk, and some people say, oh, Vietnam was a colony. The French just take them away, just conscripted. They all conscripted labor. That not is the case. Vietnamese men are no different from American men or British men. When they heard that they got a chance to go to France, they get excited. They go ahead and volunteer so that they got to go to France, to go overseas, to get on the big ships. That's what they heard. And then they will also get money, because many Vietnamese are dirt poor peasants. They don't have saving. They don't have savings, so they got to go. But there's are cases when they was volunteer and they weren't accepted because they were they did not meet the height. You know, Vietnamese people like me are very short. Some of them not even 5 feet, and I'm only barely 5 feet. I wear high heels, so a little bit. I hide my I cheat a little bit. But so in order to get to go to France, you know what they did? They pay people to allow them to get on the ship to be stowed away. And then some of them, they hire people to go into the medical exam to take the exam. When they pass the exam and on the way to transport to training camp, they switch places. In those days, we don't have photo and picture like nowadays. So that's what they did. But they get caught. Some of them get caught, and some of them get caught in France. Not volunteer, deserter. Of course, not all of the military soldiers want to go to France. They hear about war, they hated it, they're afraid, they do not know. They heard that France is 7,000 miles away, so they was afraid, they don't want to go. And many have children, they didn't want to go. Similar to today, right? In America, during the U.S. war, many people are drafted to war, they escaped. So the same with Vietnamese. And or some people coming in just like today, they declare that, oh, I'm sick, I have TB or whatever, to escape they have to go. And there were cases of forced conscription. This is the case when the Vietnamese, when village notable, village council member arrest men that they don't want to be, homeless peasant, for example, and landless peasant or criminal in the village, they forced them to go. And in this case, there was revolt, people uprising, and they come and destroy the communal center, and the French government came and inspected it and reprimand all of these people, remove them from their posts, or send them to prison for doing so. And so this is the trip about they get on the ship to go. I mean, if you imagine today you go on a cruise ship, yes, the ship was big like that. Nonetheless, there are very few cases of royal family member and some specialists that they sit and they work on the ship. In the beginning, there's plenty of places, room in the ship for them. So they get their own bed, they got to eat food, just like French people. And they talk about when they come to Suez Canal, they was welcomed by local people there with balloon and with pictures of the French Empire and drop balloon on them. But later, when hundreds of thousands of people volunteer, then the ship was crowded, and the situation was they would have cholera, they would have disease and illness, and some of them, there are people who die on the ship. And there are people, they get so sick, they jump overboard. They jump overboard. Funny that they, when they get into the Red Sea in order to go to go through Suez Canal in order to go to Mediterranean, they jump overboard. The Vietnamese has a belief that if you jump, if you commit suicide, you jump to the village wealth and you disinfected, polluted that village in revenge of, you know, to the people with your death, and that's what happened. The Vietnamese jumped overboard in the Red Sea in order to pollute the water in revenge for the French that, for them to go. And so, but then on the ship, they also facing a German attack. There was German torpedo on the ship, and many of them die on the ship too, during that thing too. So this is just to give you an idea. There's all together 18 battalions, and 4 was in combat. Majority of them as laborer, military laborer. They transport the sick, they transport the wounded, they work in the hospital, they transport munition, they dig trenches. But there's are cases they get on the battlefield in Verdun, in Chemin des Dames, in Champagne, in the other places where they fight with American soldier, with French soldier, and even with British soldier. As you can see, they serve at guard, and they encounter in their break time. They didn't want to go out. They're afraid to get out of the camp because at that time the French people was hungry. Didn't have enough food to eat. But as soldiers, even though they are soldiers from Vietnam, they had more than they can eat. Soldier, I'm talking about. So in their free time, they went over to the British camp and they learned English. That's how they learn English from. And they take classes to learn French and learn Vietnamese, how to read or write, because many of them were illiterate. And worker, as I briefly mentioned, they work in factory. And they work alongside French women, and they learn how to produce. Later on, toward the end of the war, they learn how to make men make bomb, and men make grenade, and all of those things, so which would help them later in their war against the French. The common experience. Come on, soldier or worker, and I'm sure that if you study about World War I, you know that some of these experience also happened to the French, except American. American is a different group of people. Their experience in France are different. But they experienced the brutality of modern warfare. You know, bomb shower on top of them, many of them got injured. And there's a romantic moment when they see dogfight, the airplane fighting. And one of them wrote letter to their families in Vietnam. And this is what he said. He said, there was airplane fighting with each other, and they circle around, and they move up and down similar to the bamboo leaves fallen in a storm in Vietnam. That's how he described the dogfights between soldiers. They experience, we will talk about that in detail maybe later if you have questions. They live, this is the first time the Vietnamese left the bamboo hatches of their village to get out, not to go to a different city. Some of them don't even know Hanoi. They don't even know the next city because of them. They just confined to their bamboo, to their village. And now this is the first time they went to France. They encounter international forces. They encounter the British. They encounter the Belgium and the people, refugee from everywhere. And so that changed their life, changed their perception. Just like me, when I come here, I've been in Vietnam, I see American in Vietnam. Vietnam when I came here. Americans in America, US are different from what I imagined when I was in Vietnam. Different group of people, different personality, different culture. Here, then they learn a lot of things. They learn so-called human rights, that they have the freedom of speech, that they can form political organization, association. They can demonstrate. If they don't like their boss, they can demonstrate the protest to demand more salary for more money and then demand better treatment. They can do so. And they become, one important thing is, like I say, most of them were illiterate peasant. And when they came to France, the French opened classes to teach them French and Vietnamese. And that's it, because once you can read, that you are empowered. You are empowered to think for yourself, and you are empowered to stand up for yourself. That is important thing. That's the most important thing. And another important thing is they have saving. In the first year in France, the Vietnamese was able to save in the bank, I'm not talking about other money, 5.3 million gold francs. When they left Vietnam, they are dirt poor peasants. Some of them only have one set of clothing to wear all year round, and then in the winter they have to use straw to make a coat for themselves to prevent winter cold, and they pay 5.3 million saving. They're talking about money order they send through the mail or money they spend in France. So you can see being wealthy changed their perception too. And that is something that they never experienced in Vietnam. And they have money. So the French in France look at them differently, too, especially French women. During the war, their men go to war, and nobody take care of them. And the war, they become hungry because no food. And they married Vietnamese men to get food. And so I am moving very quickly, right? But this is post-war development. Some are allowed to stay in France to learn a new trade, to go to school for better learning, higher education. And some stay because they want to stay in, and they have a French lover, or they have a French wife and French children. But the majority of them return to Vietnam. This is the thing. Like me, I come back to Vietnam. I found that I could not fit in anymore. I'm too Americanized. But in America, I'm too Vietnamese. That's what the comment I get. You're still very Vietnamese. And then I come back to Vietnam. Oh, you're too Americanized. And even Vietnamese in America, when I give a talk to Vietnamese community, you know, oh, you're too Americanized. And I told them, I say, don't you wish, right? Don't you wish, because then don't you wish you have the education like I do, right? So they found it difficult, but when just one man found it difficult, that's one thing, but 100,000 men nearly found it difficult, you know that what happened, and you can tell if you know Vietnam War. Later on, they rose up, they threw the French out of Vietnam. And then, so that is mentality. Now they come back and they say, okay, you never been out of the country. I am the one who go overseas. I know better. I can speak French. I can read French. I can do everything. I know the French well. And you, what do you know? So that is the mentality. And so they sidestep the local government, deal directly with the French authority. They help the people in the village challenge the French authority. And some of them, they joined the revolt, nationalist movement. And nationalist movement, they learned it when they was in France. 1919, when Woodrow Wilson had the 14 points, and one of which was advocating independence and national self-determination for the people in the colony. They come back to France, the French in Vietnam hasn't changed. Still treat them just like they treat illiterate peasant, and they come back to in France, they make so much money, they get back to Vietnam, they have to compete with people for 10 cents job, 10 cents a day. So that you can see a lot of frustration. Conclusion, I go quickly, but in conclusion, it's World War I removed the barrier. Until then, until 1914, the Vietnamese not allowed to go to France. Only few ranking member of the royal court would go to France for whatever the reason, and some Catholic would go to France to study because the Catholic Church took them to France to study. But then these people go to France, 100,000 went. And after the war, the barrier was wiped out. More Vietnamese were allowed to come to France to study and work. So in effect, World War I removed the barrier. Imagine if Obama successful in allowing more immigrants come to from Mexico or Latin America, this society will change. This society will change. Like me, I come here already changed, and I'm sure I changed some of the perception about American in America about Vietnamese, right? I remember some people say to me to say, oh, most of the Vietnamese married American during the war. They were bar girls. I'm not a bar girl, but look at me, you know. So I told them that. So they changed perception of the French on Vietnamese people, but they also changed the perception of their people toward the French. And like I say, they were transformed. Their experience in 4 years. 4 years is a lot. 4 years is nothing, but 4 years is a lot when you live in the situation where constantly change. You constantly have to work to survive. You constantly deal with racism. You constantly deal with hunger and how to survive in the battlefield or in the factory. So they work together to form. This is a provocative conclusion I have recently into a paper two articles I just sent. I say that briefly in my book, but World War I. Without World War I, and I say this with conviction, and I submit my paper reviewer and say that I argue it, because without World War I, the Vietnamese would not come to France. They would not allow 100,000 people and later on go to France. But if they go to France, where in France they were exposed to socialism and later to communism, it is in France that they make contact with Russian. It is in France that Russia, the Comintern, recruit Vietnamese to Russia to train them and send them back to Vietnam to overthrow the French. Without World War I, that would not happen. Ho Chi Minh would never be the leader of any anti-colon, because it is in France that Ho Chi Minh, I'm sure most of you know Ho Chi Minh, was able to make contact with Russia. And then they financed him to lead the movement against the French and later on to overthrow not only the French, but as you know. So most of us know Ho Chi Minh or the nationalist movement of Vietnam just thinking they are against the French or whatever, but it is Russia. Because I'm sure you know, or maybe you don't, is that right after World War I, Lenin was thinking about export communism and try to start a national revolution, a communist revolution, we call it at the time Bolshevik revolution in France. It didn't work because the French people say our country was in war, the British people say no, the German people say no, our country were devastating. So Lenin had the policy trying to export it to Asia, and it were people like Ho Chi Minh, Chu En Lai, Deng Xiaoping, that he exported to Asia. And so people keep thinking about World War I and thinking about World War II and 1945. But no, it is World War I. That is important. And not many people talk about that, and I am the one who do so. So thank you very much. And if you have any question.
Why don't you join me here and we'll sit for a little while. Here's your binder. Well, a really insightful conversation, thank you. I commented that if it was later, we would have had glasses of Australian wine, no doubt, but at least we've got rice wine to drink this afternoon. Thank you. There's a whole lot of what you talked about there, Kimloan, and let's unpack just a couple of pieces in about the next 20 minutes or so, and explore those a little. But before we do that, you yourself have a really intriguing story. Both you and I are immigrants to this country.
Immigrant.
That's right. So talk to us a little about your story and about place. Tell us a little about you.
Okay. I came to this country in 1977. As you know, the U.S. withdrew from Vietnam in 1973. But actually, Vietnam fell, Saigon, I'm talking about South Vietnam, fell in 1975. Before that, I worked for a different American company, AT&T, International Telephone and Telegram, as a personnel specialist. And then I worked for Catholic Relief Services in Vietnam, U.S. Catholic Relief Services in Vietnam. And the abbreviation for Catholic Relief Services in Vietnam is CRNS. When the war ends, number one, anybody who worked for American have to register yourself. I did, but I lie, and I say that I worked, I was a student of University of Saigon, which is true. But when, at the end of the war, I was no longer, but I worked as the assistant director for the orphanage improvement program. If you watch TV, you see like the airlift. Orphans airlift, I was the one who put the children on that plane, and I'm supposed to be on that plane, and I didn't because I want to wait to be able to bring my whole family out of Vietnam. And so at the war end, I was sent to what they call re-education camp for a year, and they say that I was a good citizen, so they released me. And I remember I told the leader of the camp, when I got the piece of paper that released me, and I said to him, I said, I have always been a good citizen. The only thing wrong with me, I was on the other side of the fence. So I went home and I worked on the black market trading gold, trading food, national contraband, and to make a living, because then I couldn't find a job. And I heard that people were leaving Vietnam by boat, and there's only one or two, but we heard it through BBC or Voice of America. That was so I bought my own boat, I hired people, and I organized my own trip out of Vietnam. I am boasting, but I am the only woman who ever organized my trip out of Vietnam by boat. And I was able to take my youngest brother with me, but I left my sister on shore and run. So we float in the sea for 1 week, and U.S. Navy picked me up, brought me to Singapore, and in Singapore, I became interpreter, translator for U.S. Embassy, French Embassy, Canadian Embassy, and Dutch Embassy for refugees who were flooding out and are not allowed to go to those countries. And then they, when the movement so big, they sent me to the U.S., and I live in Connecticut. I was going to New York to work in the headquarters of the Catholic, U.S. Catholic again, but I decided I didn't like New York because I have a little brother, he was 10 at the time to raise. So I stay in Connecticut, and I work for Aetna Life and Casualty, an insurance company, and I get married, and after I married my husband, I moved to Michigan, and I was a chef on the cooking shows, and I taught home ec. And I didn't like my husband anymore, so I ran away from him when we moved to Missouri. I won't tell you why I don't like him, but just that's it. And I chose Missouri, St. Louis. That's why I say I come from St. Louis. St. Louis is where I rise, if you use the term from ashes. That's why I went into shelter for the homeless, I have nothing. And I didn't know what to do with my life, and say prayer, the only thought came to me was to go to school. So I went to University of Missouri and applied to school, and I didn't know that you have to go through all kind of SAT tests and things. And so they tell me, I say no. So I staged a one-person strike. I stayed for 1 week, And they let me in. Every day I just show up with a peanut butter sandwich. In those days they don't have bottle. I just drink water. So the director feels so sick of me, he called me in. He gave me $5. He said, $5? He said, you go get some lunch this afternoon, you come back, I'll tell you my decision. And I told him, I say, I don't want your money. I want to go to school. And he said, but how about your English? And I told him, I say, do you understand me so far? He said, yes. So I told him, I say, so I have no problem with English then. And so now I think he's the vice chancellor for university. I still owe him the $5. So that's it. I go to school and then I work for the advertise. Do you know, like, there is a newspaper, the Auto Trader. Does anybody know about that? In those days, I worked there as an advertiser, in supervisor for advertising room. And then when I finished the BA, I get a job with Arthur Anderson. But thank God I didn't, because else I lost all of my pension by now.
Yeah.
I moved to Oregon to study for my MA, PhD, and by the time I finished my PhD, I was already nearly 53. I couldn't get a tenure job anywhere teaching history, but University of California hired me to teach a special program for Vietnamese American, teaching language, and at the same time, we call it cultural heritage for Vietnamese American. And so I have been there for 16 years, this is my 17. So I teach and I do research, and here I am.
Isn't that a great story? Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Kimloan, you failed to mention that the country you really wanted to go to was Australia.
Oh, yes. We have to mention that because he's from Australia. When I get out in Singapore, we have to apply. We apply on the list of four countries that we want to go. So they would choose number one, number two, number three. My number one is Australia. At that time, I still resented American for leaving Vietnam. So I applied to go to Australia. And American, U.S. actually on number three. But for some reason, they just say no, and they send me to the U.S. So I hope you don't feel offended because you are American, but at that time, that's what I think. But because I speak English and I met a very nice young man, he said that, why don't you go to Australia? My parents will sponsor you. And so his parents sponsor me, and then my USCC, U.S. Catholic Relief Services sponsor me. So they sent me over. And they offered me a job in New York, but I don't like to have beer. I could not afford to stay in wealthy area. I have to stay. That time, they told me I have to stay in Bronx area. And I look at it, they say, no. I have a little brother. I don't want to lock my brother in the door all the time. So I moved to Connecticut. That's how my life began.
And then, of course, the conclusion of that story is that after finishing with husband number one, then she married an Australian.
My number two is Australian. I met him in Vietnam, and he told me, he said, it's fate, because I have to go around the world before I can come to Australia. But I have to tell you, he keep asking me to retire and go to Australia to live, and I have to say no. I say no. This is my country now. I rise up, rise here, and then I'll die here.
Well, that's probably time for us to finish the conversation then. Dr. Hill.
But he came to America, too, yeah. Right? Something very good about America.
That's right. Let me ask you, talk a little about how the Vietnamese men who went to France, mm-hmm. how they were treated, and then the impact that had on them when they returned back to Vietnam.
Well, when they get back to Vietnam, I was saying briefly, like I come back to Vietnam, I see that I don't belong. Even though I still have friends, I still have family back there, but I felt very lonely in Vietnam. Because the same with those men, they came back, they found out that they already crossed the line, being a Vietnamese.
So how did that happen in France? What was their experienced different like then in France?
Well, in France, they got to, you see the picture, they got to dress up in Western country. Many of them never wear shoes. In France, they got to wear shoes, and they couldn't wear it, so when they don't have to go to the battlefield, they take their shoes off and they walk bare feet, and they get infection. And so in France, they got to live like a French person. Even though there are racism, later on we may talk about it, but they live, they got to go anywhere, they got to travel from one village to another to visit their friend. Nobody tell them where to go and what to do. They can do so. They can go up there, is what they saw the French. I hate to say this, some people think that I'm broke French because I speak French fluently and learn French and English in Vietnam, but the French set up social club for these French Vietnamese people come, where they can read book, where they can socialize, where they can write letter to their family in Vietnam, where they can listen to Vietnamese music. Nobody ever treated them. And then in France, they contact. They make contact with American. You may not believe this, but after the war is over, I found record that the governor of Indochina, the French governor, set up the what they call Veteran Association. And every year for 5 years, that American soldier went to Vietnam and celebrate Christmas in Vietnam to reunite it with their Vietnamese counterpart. And therefore, when you go through those things, you come back to Vietnam, the Vietnamese, most of them, I would say they are just 0.00001% of the people in Vietnam that was exposed to, I'm talking about common people, exposed to the Western culture and Western way of life. And they come back to Vietnam. Everybody was still back in 19th century, 18th, 19th century. Of course, they changed. They challenged the authority, like I briefly mentioned before. They disobeyed authority. They told those people, what do you know? And then they also changed in the sense that they want power. They think that the French should use them in the administration, not the mandarins, which is the people who work for the court. And the French did. French established, the president, I don't remember his name now, but he created a new law in 1926 to allow all Vietnamese, regardless where, to compete with French citizens. I'm talking French Vietnamese become French citizen or French colonists in Vietnam for all kind of job, but it's too late. It's too late because by that time they decided to remove the French. Ho Chi Minh already become famous and he tried to, and then many Vietnamese students went to France to study. They decided we don't want to be their servant anymore. And nationalism and national independence, that the idea promulgate, introduced to the colonies people by Woodrow Wilson, make not only the Vietnamese, the Chinese, the African, the Algerian think. But the Algerians, I feel sorry for them. It wasn't until 1956 or 1960 before they get their independence.
So there's some irony in here, isn't it? That the French, their colonization of Vietnam and China, and resulting in those 100,000 going to France.
Yeah.
And in the process, there's an awareness and an empowerment of them that ends up, you're proposing, causes the deconstruction of the colonial powers in Vietnam.
Yeah, they come back, they want the same kind of job they had in France. But the same kind of job they had in France did not exist in Vietnam because Vietnam didn't produce everything on the assembly line, and that's what they did. This is the thing. They came back and they see themselves as specialists, a specialist in shoes, specialist in this and that, and the Vietnamese in Vietnam laughed at them too, thinking, what kind of specialist is that? You can only pow one nail and you can only do one part. But we are shoes maker. We can make the whole shoes. And so Vietnamese, I can make the whole dress, but you come over there, you just sit there and you assemble the one part. And so they are laughed at, not only by the French colon, but by the French colon, they, of course, they feel threatened too. They don't want to release their power. They want to control these people. So there's a newspaper article by the French colon, they control, they wrote, they challenged. They say, how are we going to deal with them? We change them, they are a different breed of men when they come back now. They are arrogant and they are smarter. How are we going to control them? Of course, the answer was, okay, not the French dealing with them, but they deal with the French and boot the French out of Vietnam.
So, Kimloan, you're saying here that the French in France treated the Vietnamese differently than the French in Vietnam.
Yes, yes. The reason so, because the French in France are just the French in France are different. When they come there, they come with the purpose of exploiting Vietnamese resource. Just like American big company, you know, they go to Latin America, they set up company, they exploit the resource. So they treat the local people are different. But the French in France, these people come, they appreciate these people come and save them from the German. Number one, number thing, in France at that time, as any of you study European history, you know that the French is what we call progressive at that time. They are way before the American in human rights issues, in women issues, in liberty and in freedom, equality, egality, and all of those things. So when these people come, they treat them the same. I'm not saying all of them, but there's a conflict and racism. If you ask me, I'll tell you. If you don't ask me, I'll keep it for myself. But they facing, so they feel free. And one of the things that, fact, they go to prostitution in the same brothel like Frenchmen. And they find out that Frenchmen, some of the Frenchmen, they always look at them being superior. Being superior, they're French people, so they are superior than us. Right? But when they come to France, they find that some of the Frenchmen are laborers just like them. One of the soldiers wrote a letter to their wife in Vietnam or to their mother in Vietnam that these Frenchmen in our country, they are our master. But when they come back to their country, they have to scrape mud from their shoes just like all of us. So that's different. I'm sure like when the Vietnam War happened, there's some of you who go to Vietnam just barely get out of high school and some of you already college degree. So different right there. So the same thing. And so when they come back to Vietnam, they look at these people. But go back to French history a little bit, is that the French need to expansion in the 19th century, as we know, to need new resource because of industrialization. But the one that go to Vietnam and Asia, I don't know about Africa, but I didn't study, so I can say, they all, they don't have a job, so they follow some of the leader to go to Vietnam, and they were promised a piece of land and all of these things, so they go. Some of them are not even educated. But they come, they lord, I have to use that term, over Vietnamese people. But Vietnamese people at that time, the majority are oppressed by the Mandarin. If they can find a job in the plantation, they think that's a step up in the society. But then they're still oppressed, beaten up by the owner of the plantation. If you watch the movie Indochina, then you can see what I mean. But when they went to France, they got their eye, just like somebody removed the curtain on their eye. They see that they are, I am a human being. I am a human being. You have no right to treat me. What are you so different from the French? You come here, you take my resource, you come here, you control our people, and you act like you are God, and you are not God, right? So that's how things change.
Good. Yeah. I wonder if there might be some questions from the audience. We have some microphones or which are down here. You're welcome to move, or if you wish, stand, and if I need to,
I am a little bit, I'm deaf.
So I'll restate the question.
I'll give it a try.
Thank you.
It's been, 40 years since the fall of Saigon and everything that cascaded from that. What is the political and cultural scene like back in Vietnam? Although I know you live here and you're an American citizen.
Sure.
What do you hear as far as what things are like in Vietnam now?
Okay.
So the question is about what's the current condition now, like the political conditions in Vietnam. We're 40 years out since the fall of Saigon.
Okay. I have been going back to Vietnam since 1994, every year as the director for the Vietnamese Advanced Summer Institute sponsored by the Department of Education, U.S. Department of Education every year, and I can see how they change. 94, I went back. And I remember the Vietnamese woman in Hanoi, you know, that had been communist since 1954 and had always been. She said that only since the open up of the country, you know, that Russia, the Berlin Wall fall, and then Russia become a democratic country, she said that they were allowed to wear colorful clothing. Before, they only have three sets of clothing, man or woman, brown, black, and white. Black to wear, brown and black to wear on the field, and white to go to official meetings and stuff. I get back there, and I remember, I get back there to work at 94. I get back there to do research, and to avoid being scrutinized, I apply to go back there to do research on woman history. And I, at that time, you don't see motorcycle, only bicycle. And I rode my bicycle around, but they sent someone. I have to pay that person $50 a month. This is about 20 years ago, $50 a month to follow me. And when I went, in those days, the communists in the North, I just used that term, North Vietnam didn't know the value of books like we do. We love books and we love old books. So they dump books out on the street and sell by kilo. So I went and I chose some book, and actually some of my book now worth about $2,000 per book. And I bought just weight kilo for me, so I pay all together. But the person who followed me come over and told me, you cannot buy this book, you cannot buy this book. And I remember at one point I was so upset with her, and I speak in English to her, so she could not understand what I say. I shake her and I said to her, this is my money, I can buy any book if I want to. And then she asked me, she said, what did you say? I say, nothing. I just feel homesick. That's what happened in 1994. But now you come back, you can do anything except if you start making connection against the government, or if you say anything against the government, the next hour or the evening, someone come in and take you away. I came back there to every summer when I'm there, I go to the archive, do research, and I lie on my paper. I say I'm doing research about religion, I'm doing research about culture or whatever, and then I type the information, don't relate. Sometimes they caught me, they say, your topic is about Vietnamese culture. What are you copying about VC being killed or being tortured by American here, you know? But that's it. And right now, with the internet, as you know, Vietnamese government have hard time controlling. So they are cracking down on internet right now. But the problem with Vietnam, as you know, similar to China, similar to Russia, communism didn't work. Communism did not work. So they have to open up their country and allow their people to go overseas to study. But these people overseas to study, they think and they change. Yeah. 3 months ago when I gave a talk, graduate student from Vietnam, they were studying in Portland. When I gave a talk, and then they told me, say, nobody ever taught us these things. So imagine another impact of Western, I hate to use the term Western power, Western culture going to have impact in Vietnam, and we watch 10 years from now to see what happened. But one more thing, very important. Vietnamese was Confucian. And Confucian culture, Confucian study is embedded in Vietnamese mind. It runs in the blood. Even me, I'm teaching in 21st century, but when I'm talking about a woman in Vietnam, and then I realize I'm still very much that model of woman, even though I'm wearing skirt and all of the things, outspoken, but I am still very much adhere to many, many Confucian teaching. We grew up, we were trained. So for Vietnam to change completely, the current generation of leader have to, like my generation had to die out and the new generation will come in. Because some of them, they don't even know Trần Văn Dầu. I'm sure you don't know, but Trần Văn Dầu is a revolution hero, and he was a historian party, Communist Party historian, but no one know. So it tell me that the government right now realize they cannot talk about communist revolution anymore, but now they focus more on economic issue, produce and make money so that people have more jobs. And but I'm not saying that they care about the people. That's a different issue. We are not talking here today.
Thank you. We have one more question, then I have a final question. Sir. So the question is that as I understand it, so you're saying there that those who rose up with who into power were the ones who were the more confident, the ones who were asserted themselves. They knew what they wanted. And so the question is how do leaders nowadays, however, balance that with a sense of humility? I think the gentleman's asking about the nature of social change. We don't know where it's going to lead.
World War One or currently?
Just in more general, learning the lessons from World War One. There are consequences to decisions made that we sometimes don't know what those are. How do we help leadership be humble in their leadership? Do you have any opinion about that?
Yeah, leadership in Vietnam, no way humble. They don't humble. It is a society where the stratify. And the Confucian thing that we still practice, they still practice when you have to respect authority. And in under Confucian, I just wrote an article and before World War One, that the king orders someone to die, regardless what the reason that subject had to die. And so is Vietnamese society. When the parent in my time, when I'm there, they can beat their children, can kill their children, no question to ask. And they can beat up their servant and kill their servant, no question to ask. And right now, with the so that is the reason why the people change. They want, when people like Ho Chi Minh, they come there and they see, so that's why we have a revolution. But right now, there is only one party in Vietnam, that is the Communist Party. And they still tightly control. They would let people say so far. And talking, if you know how to read Vietnamese, you can see they talk about anything except challenging the government. This is just one example, quick example. A few years ago, the government, the land in Vietnam now is owned by the communist government. Everybody had the right to use it, but nobody owned the land. And so it means the government can take over anytime they want. Few years ago, the government, but actually who's the government, as you know, few leaders in the government right now, they decided to take over a big piece of land that the Catholic Church owned in Hanoi that was housing the people who learn how to be priests, seminarians, right? Mm-hmm. They decided to take that piece of land and rent it to a Korean company to produce. So the church protest. They arrested the priest, the leader of that protest. He go out, he chained himself to the church fence, and he was arrested. So they put him on trial. And there's a couple of Vietnamese like me, study in England, study in Oxford in law. They came back to Vietnam and opened a law office in Vietnam. And mostly for them, we could deal with law, like you are speeding and all of the law. But the church in the north, contact these lawyers and ask them to be their lawyer, defense lawyer, because they don't trust Vietnamese lawyer, because Vietnamese lawyer, they come out, they're just party line again. On the day of the court hearing, Saigon and Hanoi, it's only 90 minutes fly. These lawyers come to go to the airport in Saigon in order to fly to Hanoi to defend the priest. Guess what? Somebody going out, take them, and they disappear. Even today, we don't know where they are. Just disappear. And the court proceeding with the appointed defense lawyer and with the prosecutor, and what they call people's court, and you know how people's court are. And so the priest is condemned to prison. There is still that situation.
So that's still the case then, that human rights continue to be a struggle, and that leadership continues to be a something that is still within the hands of the very few, Dr. Hill.
I don't think the microphone...
Let me hold perhaps that conversation until we complete the Q&A time, because we just have a few moments, and I have one final question for you, Dr. Hill, which is, so what do you think is the most significant lasting legacy of World War I on modern Vietnam? What's the most enduring legacy?
Well, I concluded my book that without World War I, the revolution, the communist revolution, probably would never take place, because it is in France that people like Ho Chi Minh, like all of the party leader, the communist, Vietnamese Communist Party, was exposed to nationalism and communism. And then they exposed to Russia and come back and overthrown. Without World War I, I think Ho Chi Minh or the Communist Party would never become the leader of revolution. There may be some kind of revolution that the French eventually had to move out of Vietnam. But without them, without Ho Chi Minh, Ho Chi Minh would not be the leader of revolution, because it is in France that he was exposed. And I am disclosed a secret that I just filed last year in France. Ho Chi Minh was in the French army. He tried to hide it. He still tried to hide it. But so if in French army, that's why I read a lot of things that Vietnamese revolutionaries saying, you know, that Ho Chi Minh became a leader among the soldiers in World War I, because he was there. So he's starting to know exactly what to talk, what to say, and what to do. So that's what happened. And then the war lasted until 75, finished in 75. It didn't finish when Vietnam was divided half and half, because Ho Chi Minh, of course, he fight for a piece for the whole pie, but he would cut, just give him a piece of pie. He want to finish it. He want to take the whole Vietnam, because that's what he won when the French withdrew from Vietnam. So that's the lasting legacy of World War I. People think that it is World War II and American involvement, that is how, but no, it is World War I. Without World War I, Vietnam probably forever under the king, maybe like Thailand and maybe something else, we don't know. I cannot make a hypothesis here, because the forces, the modern time, the forces are so dynamics and all of those things, we never know. But Vietnam right now, believe me, I think that it will change. Because then I teach Vietnamese from Vietnam out every day, and they get to learn from me, including my perspective about Ho Chi Minh and everyone else. And one of my students just concluding his paper, Ho Chi Minh is just a common man, like everybody. He's not a god like the Communist Party make him to be. He's common man like all of us, right? He have to struggle to fight for his job. And when he will push against the wall, then he followed the Russian, because the Russian provide him education, food, and money. Did you know that in the war, the year from 1920 until 1937, the Russian gave him more than, beginning only 800 something thousand dollars, US dollar per year. And imagine how much it is to finance his revolution movement, just so that he can go here and there. And then when he finally, 1937, when he was chosen to lead the Vietnamese Communist Party, more. But no one talked about that, right? So that's the legacy of World War I in Vietnam.
Well, that's I think a fascinating conversation. You've clearly outlined these connections, the fibers which join together the founding catastrophe of the 20th century with the experience of the people of Vietnam. Thank you, Dr. Hill. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking Dr. Hill.
Thank you for being here.